Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Prayer Watch tonight, the 1st of July. Let us prepare our hearts and our minds and our spirits to worship the Lord. Let us pray. Eternal God, our Father in heaven, we come before you, Lord, with praise and thanksgiving. Our hearts are full because indeed you are good and your love endures forever. We praise you, Lord, for everything that has been this day. We thank you for what is right now. And we thank you even for the things that will be in the coming hours, in the coming days. Because such is our faith and trust in you, Father. You are indeed our good Father who looks after us, who loves us with an everlasting love. Thank you for this time that we can gather your people once again in worship, in prayer, and in praise. We ask you, God, to be with us, to speak to us, and to tell us of your message for each one of us in a very personal way. Father, forgive us our sins. Forgive us, Lord, for the thoughts, the speech, the motives of our hearts, the acts and deeds, and the inaction which are in disobedience to your will. Forgive us, Lord. Have mercy upon us. Wash us and purify us from all unrighteousness. We ask you, Father, to prepare us for worship so that we can worship you in the spirit and in truth. And we depend on you, O Holy Spirit of the living God, to give us wisdom from above, spiritual wisdom from the spiritual words that you will proclaim to us. We praise you, Lord, and we thank you. Because we ask this all in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord. Amen.
Psalm 107. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord tell their story. Those he redeemed from the hand of the foe. Those he gathered from the lands, from east and west, from north and south. Some wandered in desert wastelands, finding no way to a city where they could settle. They were hungry and thirsty, and their lives ebbed away. Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he delivered them from their distress. He led them by a straight way to a city where they could settle. Let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for mankind. For he satisfies the thirsty and fills the hungry with good things. Some sat in darkness, in utter darkness, prisoners suffering in iron chains, because they rebelled against God's commands and despised the plans of the Most High. So he subjected them to bitter labor. They stumbled, and there was no one to help. Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them from their distress. He brought them out of darkness, the utter darkness, and broke away their chains. Let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for mankind. For he breaks down gates of bronze and cuts through bars of iron. Some became fools through their rebellious ways and suffered affliction because of their iniquities. They loathed all food and drew near the gates of death. Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them from their distress. He sent out his word and healed them. He rescued them from the grave. Let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for mankind. Let them sacrifice thank offerings and tell of his works with songs of joy. Some went out on the sea in ships. They were merchants on the mighty waters. They saw the works of the Lord, his wonderful deeds in the deep. For he spoke and stirred up a tempest that lifted high the waves. They mounted up to the heavens and went down to the depths. In their peril, Their courage melted away. They reeled and staggered like drunkards. They were at their wits' end. Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he brought them out of their distress. He stilled the storm to a whisper. The waves of the sea were hushed. They were glad when it grew calm, and he guided them to their desired haven. Let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for mankind. Let them exalt him in the assembly of the people and praise him in the council of the elders. He turned rivers into a desert, flowing springs into thirsty ground, and fruitful land into a salt waste because of the wickedness of those who lived there. He turned the desert into pools of water and the parched ground into flowing springs. There he brought the hungry to live, and they founded a city where they could settle. They sowed fields and planted vineyards that yielded a fruitful harvest. He blessed them, and their numbers greatly increased, and he did not let their herds diminish. Then their numbers decreased, and they were humbled by oppression, calamity, and sorrow. He who pours contempt on nobles made them wander in a trackless waste. But he lifted the needy out of their affliction and increased their families like flocks. The upright see and rejoice, but all the wicked shut their mouths. Let the one who is wise heed these things and ponder the loving deeds of the Lord.
For the nth time, I will be prefacing my sermon tonight with reference to our common predicament, that is the global pandemic. But at this time tonight, I would like to focus on a time for thanksgiving. And just like what God's word is, a double-edged sword that hurts and heals, so are our life experiences. The tragedies coexist with the triumphs, the laughter with the tears, the stress with the ease. And so I know that we have cried out to the Lord because of our pains, our difficulties, our sufferings. But now is a time for thanksgiving, says the 107th Psalm, which we have just read tonight. This psalm instructs us to do in times of extraordinary difficulties and uncertainty. It says, "Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord tell their story." Let the redeemed of the Lord, let those who have been rescued, who have been liberated, who have been delivered from one difficulty to another, tell their story and testify that indeed God is good. There are thousands of stories to tell about God's goodness, his provisions, his protection, in the generosity of the people close to us as well as strangers, the heroism of the frontliners who risked their lives, who burned the midnight oil to deliver their services to their students, to their constituencies, and so on. Even the parents are frontliners who have served as a comfort and even shock absorbers of the rest of the members of the family. All of them, perhaps, deserve to be documented, stories that need to be recorded in one form or another. But whatever form your story may be, or whatever it may be, whether you would prefer to say it in poetry, in prose, in dance, in pictures, the call of the hour is to give thanks to the Lord and to tell the story, your story, of his salvation. And so, let me tell you a story of a day in my life yesterday, which is about all I can tell you within this brief sermon time allocation, at least for now. Because I believe it is a beautiful and amusing, in fact, an amusing sampler of the ways God is good in our day-to-day experiences. I started the day quite ambitiously with a number of things to do. And considering yesterday was the end of the month, and with more people getting back to their pre-ECQ mode, I knew it was going to be a challenging day, negotiating traffic and all, but nevertheless, I was, as usual, hopeful at the beginning of the day. And so I got what I needed to prepare some dish to celebrate my sister's birthday, but unfortunately, I was not able to get the 4 pieces of avocados that I needed for my salad, so that made me a little disappointed, but I had to go on with the rest of the day. I proceeded to drop off and pick up my assistant Evans in the bank. Then I was off to a messengerial errand to pick up materials for our church school. Traffic was heavy from Las Piñas to Parañaque and back, and so that took me quite that chopped off a lot of time in my schedule. And so I prayed, I said, Father, bring me on time to the bank because I have to fund an issued check that was due that day. And on the way, I suspected that the gate of the bank was going to be closed, so I had to think fast where to turn so that I could get a parking space. And praise God, I got it in a residential street just behind the bank building. And I strode briskly to the entrance of the bank. I greeted my favorite guard and spoke, called out his name, just mentioned his name, and he whisked me to the next seat in line where I was attended to immediately. Thank God I made it to the 3 o'clock deadline. I was very happy when I left the bank, but I had to rush back home to take a full bath, as has become the requirement of everyone in the house whenever we enter the house after a trip outside during this community quarantine period. There was not even time for a quick lunch, so after Evans had loaded all the stuff and filled up our car, gotten everything ready for delivery to the Cavite destinations, which we had a number of stopovers, we were on our way to Bacoor to pick up more of the stuff to be brought to General Trias in our Il Giardino church. But the keys did not match any of the gates of our Bacoor worship hall because, as we learned soon enough, the padlocks had been changed and we were not given duplicate keys. But praise God, a member living nearby had a copy of the keys and we were able to get in, and we were off to our next stop. But just as we barely had closed the gate and we were on our way along that very narrow esquinita or interior road, lo and behold, another problem was in the offing, as a large SUV came, was there, right there, coming to us in the opposite direction. And of course, as I said, it was a very narrow alley, and that was the problem. And I could see that the driver could not understand my signal to have her back up a little bit so that it would give me more room. She wouldn't budge. So I found myself without any choice but to take a brave plunge into the inevitable. Again, I cried out silently to God to help me out of that literally tight situation without falling into the hole in the right side of the road And so I asked Evans to get off the car to help watch whether my tires were still on the road. And before I knew it, about five people, men and women, just materialized from nowhere. I don't know, probably because of my nervousness, I didn't even notice that they had already congregated right there on that side of the road. And they, together with Evan, started coaching and cheering me on to just go forward, directing me where to put or to shift the wheel of the car. And according to Evans, my tires were just about an inch from falling into the ditch. But praise God, the signals for me to hold came just in time to renegotiate, and I gingerly inched my way. During that whole time, it seemed as if I was driving with my eyes blindfolded, but just hoping and praying I would get through and the car would get through unscratched, unscathed. To make a long story short, we made it to far away Tanza, Cavite, a place that we were going to for the very first time, thanks to Waze, to drop off our first batch of relief goods for a member. By this time, it was past 7:30 in the evening and I was really getting hungry. We were surprised that our member there had actually prepared a feast for us, because she was expecting us to have lunch or at least dinner. God saved me again from that, my hunger, and I had two big quick spoonfuls of the spaghetti carbonara and with a bag full of take-home food to boot. And after a prayer for the family, we were off to the next stop, which was General Trias in Cavite. By this time, it was almost 8:30, and I said that the first thing I would do upon setting foot in our Il Giardino church was go to the toilet. But it was more than a toilet stop, relief stop, because our teacher Eliza and our pastor Eileen had prepared another feast for us to celebrate Eliza's birthday. Praise the Lord for feeding the hungry, both of us plus Evans and I. And as we placed our cargoes inside the schoolroom, Pastor Eileen motioned to a plastic bag containing a dozen beautiful, freshly harvested avocados from a church member for us to take home. I said, praise God. Lord, I only asked for four avocados, but you gave me times three. Praise the Lord. Another surprise from God. The last stop was Paliparan, Das Mariñas, Cavite, to bring food packs to our church staff, Dodong, and another retired staff, the Avilas. After some difficulty finding the exact address, we finally met each other the first time after more than 3 months of the quarantine. We didn't plan to stay long because it was already like 10 in the evening. And so as I was about to start the car to prepare for us to leave, there was nothing. There was just a click. The battery was dead. I knew that sound. I had been in that situation before. So I tried it again. Nothing. No sound. Evans and I just looked at each other, speechless. The last time it happened, she was also with me. So we knew very well what that meant. The battery was out. There was no way we could do anything about it. And much less in an almost isolated place like Paliparan at 10:30 in the evening. I thought, this is it. This might be the expiration date of my battery, because it had been like 2 or 3 years ago since I had it replaced. To make a long story short, Juben, the son of our Kuya Jose and Ate Lolit Avila, biked in the middle of the night to ask around for anyone or maybe his acquaintances who might know of a mechanic. He came back after about 20 minutes with a negative report. No one was around. I had no time and didn't want to think about it anyway, about the situation, but I just quickly called everyone, the four of us together, and I said, let us pray for one another. This is the reason we are here, to pray for each other, for the families that we visited, and finally to pray that our car would start by God's miracle. I told Juben to start bringing their packs home because it was getting late, and then I went back to the car to start it one more time. What do you think happened? Well, I was not surprised to be surprised. The engine roared, and I kept pushing the pedal down to make sure that I didn't hear it wrongly, that I heard it correctly, that indeed the engine was back. And knowing that it was for real, I kept on just stepping on the pedal as hard as I could to help the battery get recharged and to keep us going. Evans and I could not help laughing and praising God for the wonderful miracle and the roller coaster ride that we had that entire day. And upon reaching home very quickly at midnight, we were both still so charged up, just like the battery, I hope, that I thought I was still good to do some cooking for a favorite delicacy. Brothers and sisters in Christ, can't you see that God's loving kindness is not only a one-time event, nor is it something that is unpredictable or unreliable? As I thought about what happened yesterday, God enabled me to replay more of the ways in which He has brought me out of so many troubles and kept me away from danger and even from disaster that probably I had no idea was already coming my way. And indeed, God's love is an enduring pattern of rescue and restoration. It is a pattern because we can trace it happening again and again in our lives. If only we learn to love God, remember Him, and see the pattern of His goodness taking the central place of our heart and minds, instead of allowing the peripheral situations to dominate, and to take their place in our memories. I recently saw a game on Facebook where you were asked to take a look at a picture, and depending on whether you saw the image of a roaring tiger or a hanging monkey, that would indicate whether you are a right-brained, predominantly creative person, or a left-brained, predominantly analytical person. Well, in our lives, we are called to be God-centered people who could see God's love, who could see the heart of God and His goodness, who could make out the image of the greatness, the reality of God's love for us, no matter where we look, no matter how we look at the situation that we are in. The 107th Psalm is a beautiful psalm for us at this time of our lives and our common experience as a nation, as well as a global family, especially for us Christians, the redeemed of the Lord. It shows the pattern of our life in relation to God. You see how the psalm repeats this pattern at least 4 times in various areas of the psalm. These words, the sentences go this way. Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and He delivered them from their distress. And then the psalm declares and narrates the way God delivered them from their troubles in various ways. After which it ends with these lines, also 4 times. And I would quote, "Let them give thanks to the Lord for His unfailing love and His wonderful deeds for mankind." In this psalm, it mentions, among others, 4 situations that commonly happen to us. First situation is this, the situation of people being lost in the wilderness, finding their way to a city, or looking for a land where they can settle. Second, the oppression of people who are enchained, imprisoned. Third, the affliction of sickness, or the consequences, the affliction that is brought about by consequences of sins. And fourthly, the dangers brought about by nature, such as being caught in the midst of the sea in a storm. These situations were based on actual experiences of the Israelites. These were not hypothetical experiences. These were dangers that happened in their lives as a nation, and the way God delivered them and rescued them from each one of them. We have our own experiences, and we can add several more to the list of 4 that we see mentioned here. They speak of literal hardships, the physical hardships, but they also refer to the spiritual condition of darkness of the soul, of sinfulness and condemnation before God rescued us by the grace, by His grace, through Jesus Christ. But whatever they may be, we see that our faith is tested and God is proven true, both by the testimonies of others as well as by our very own experiences. Nakikita natin sa totoong buhay ang ibig sabihin ng ating pananampalataya. Ito ay hindi mga tukaturuan lamang, nananuan lamang na mga doktrina lang, mga tinuturo na sa isang Bible study session o sa isang preaching o sa isang sermon. Ito ay mga kwento ng totoong buhay. At itong mga karanasan na ito ay masasabi natin isang patutuo, isang sermon, isang pagpapasalamat, pagpapatutuo sa kabutihan ng ating Panginoon. And by these experiences, what does the Bible command us to do about them? They are very important. They talk about life. First, there are 4 of them that I could tell you from the psalm. First, remember those concrete experiences. It is good to remember them, my dear brothers and sisters. Put down, if need be, into writing the ways that you cried out to the Lord because of the situation. And then remember, if need be, write down the ways that He rescued you. And then remember, put down into writing the ways that you have given your thanks to the Lord. How did you celebrate the thanksgiving? Did you sing? Did you offer something? Did you offer a sacrifice of thanksgiving? Did you say a word of testimony? Did you exalt God in one or more ways? Secondly, God commands us to rejoice and celebrate God's rescue. Rejoice and celebrate. Take time to just make it, to allow it to sink in your consciousness, your heart. And thirdly, retell them to others to glorify God. One of the best ways to create that mark in your heart and to keep remembering God's goodness is to keep telling them to others. And finally, record them in your heart and in your journals. That is the importance of writing something in your devotional journals or in whatever way you have been accustomed to. Every season and every year added to our lives, to your life, should enrich us and make us wise, because we have lived out the experiences, we have learned from them, and we have loved God even more for the concrete things He has done out of His loving kindness. You see, our faith is something that we hope for that has not yet come, but it is also grounded on experiences that have actually happened and upon which we are more sure of the things that are yet to come. The psalmist says, "Let the one who is wise heed these things." Heed what? Heed whatever lessons you have gained from your experience and ponder the loving deeds of the Lord. Tonight, after this worship service, let us sing a song of thanksgiving to the Lord. And at the end of the worship, let us proceed to pray with people in the household. And let that prayer be a prayer full of thanksgiving to God, for He is good. His love endures forever. His love is a pattern of goodness, of rescue, and restoration. And then create an opportunity to share your testimony of God's goodness, His rescue, His loving rebuke, His restoration, and yes, His rewards. Praise be to God. Glory and honor, thanksgiving and praise be unto our God who is good. Amen. Let us pray. Loving God, gracious Father in heaven, indeed, there is so much we can thank you for. You are abounding in grace, full of mercy, and overflowing in your love and blessings towards your children. We thank you, O Lord, for indeed you have given us so many, many ways and experiences where we can see and prove how true and gracious you have been in our lives, how you are gracious and true today, and how you, we know, will continue to be gracious and good for the rest of our lives. Thank you, Lord, for filling us with the understanding of your goodness. Thank you for giving light to the things that are truly evidences of your workings, even in the day-to-day run of things. Thank you, Lord, for helping us and making each experience a stepping stone towards our mission of making disciples of all nations. Thank you for the encouragement of the many miracles that you continue to work out in our lives. Thank you, Lord, that indeed you are working in all things, the seemingly good and the seemingly bad, for the good, always for the good of those who love you, who are called according to your purpose. Father, thank you that in the midst of the seeming difficulty and oppressive conditions of these extraordinary times, we can sincerely and truly from the heart from the bottom of our hearts, rejoice and declare that you are good and that your love endures forever. We praise and thank you. Lord, I pray for that person who is listening right now, for everyone, O God, to know and to remember the ways in which you have been so good, and to make them realize that there are even 1,000 other blessings by way of your protection from dangers and threats that they would not have even known, because you have prevented them from happening to them and to me. Thank you, Lord. Indeed, you are so good, and we rejoice. We choose to rejoice, and we choose to thank you, Lord, because it is just right to thank a God who has so loved us with an everlasting love, unconditionally and always, without fail. You are true. Father, we pray that we will continue to put our trust in you, and that, Lord, we will be wise in the living of our days, in living it always with a deep gratitude, with a spirit of celebration for the good and wonderful life that we have, because you are our God. Most of all, Lord, we want to thank you above all for our salvation, the forgiveness of our sins, and the promise and the guarantee of an eternal life because of Jesus Christ, by your grace, through the faith that you have given us. We praise you, Lord, because from that grace have come grace upon grace, blessing upon blessing. We bless your name, O Lord, and we want to bless others by the testimonies of your goodness. Thank you so much, Father. Bless our families, bless our church, Lord. Continue to bless our nation, and bless the world that you so love. In Jesus' name, Amen.
Sing praise, yeah, forever, God. sing praise.